Hello and welcome to UGC EPG Pathshala. I am Anushree Nagpal from the Department of Geography, Jamia Millia Islamia. In this episode, we will learn about coral reefs and coral bleaching. At the end of this episode, the student should be able to explain the definition of coral reefs, recognize different types of coral reefs, explain the different theories regarding the formation of coral reefs, become aware of the importance of coral reefs and threats to the coral reefs, have a clear understanding about the coral bleaching and its causes, describe the distribution, status, conservation and protection of coral reefs in India. Introduction: Coral and coral reefs. Coral is a kind of fleshy anemone which is green, yellow, pink, violet and white in color. An individual coral is known as a polyp, a very small and simple organism consisting mostly of a stomach topped by a tentacle-bearing mouth. The polyps extend their tentacles at night to sting and ingest tiny organisms called plankton and other small creatures. Each polyp lives in a symbiotic relationship with the host called zooxanthellae that gives the coral its typical color. Zooxanthellae takes in the carbon dioxide, processes it through photosynthesis and gives off oxygen and other important nutrients that are then used by the host polyp. As in all photosynthesizing organisms, this means that corals must be exposed to a sufficient amount of sunlight. This confines most corals to shallow waters that are clean and clear. These coral polyps live in group and form a colony and forms calcareous shell around them. Coral reefs are formed when the polyps die and their skeleton accumulates over one another along a submarine platform at suitable depth. As the coral dies, the shell remains deposited and new corals attach their shells to the existing ones. This cycle of dying and depositing repeats for over millions of years, leading to accumulation of layers of coral shallow rocks created by these depositions called reef. Coral reefs over periods of time transform or evolve into coral islands, for example Lakshadweep. Coral reefs are significant submarine features of limestone and dolomite accumulated by lime secreting organisms known as coral polyps. Coral reefs are one of the most biologically diverse ecosystems on Earth, rivaled only by the tropical rainforests. They are made up not only of hard and soft corals, but also sponges, crustaceans, mollusks, fish, sea turtles, sharks, dolphins, and much more. The health, abundance, and diversity of the organisms that make up a coral reef are directly linked to the surrounding terrestrial and marine environments. Coral reefs: behavior, diet, and range. Coral polyps are mostly found in the tropical oceans between tropics of Cancer and Tropic of Capricorn. Their tolerance level to adverse condition is quite low. The average temperature required for their growth is 20 degrees Celsius, and they cannot survive at a depth where light penetration is not enough. Reefs only occur in shallow areas that are reachable by sunlight because of the relationship between the coral and algae. If the water is colder, the reefs are poorly developed or non-existent. Various types of microscopic algae known as Cymbiodinium live inside of the coral, providing them with food and helping them to grow faster. In many ways, reef-building corals are animals that act like plants. They stay in one place and get some of their energy from the sun. More precisely, coral reefs are found in shallow areas of depth of less than 150 feet. However, some coral reefs extend even deeper, up to about 450 feet deep. Both saline and fresh water are injurious to corals, thus they grow in areas of moderate salinity away from the mouth of large rivers, bringing large amount of fresh water. The water should be clean and sediment-free, because muddy water or turbid water clogs the mouth of coral polyps, resulting into their death. Very high saline water is also injurious for the growth of corals because such water contains only little amount of calcium carbonates, whereas lime is an important food for coral polyps. The oceanic salinity ranging between 27 to 30 parts per thousand is most ideal for the growth and development of coral polyps. Let us now learn about the types of coral reefs. First is a fringing reef. Fringing reefs are reefs that grow directly from a shore. They are located very close to land and often from a shallow lagoon between the beach and the main body of the reef, as has been shown in figure 1. A fringing reef runs in a narrow belt 1 to 2 km wide. This type of reef grows from the deep sea bottom with the seaward side sloping into the deep sea. This reef is the most common reef among all the reefs. Second are the barrier reefs. The barrier reefs are like fringing reefs but are situated in the sea nearly 1 km to 15 km away from the shore, as has been shown in figure 2. Therefore, navigable channel called lagoon separates these reefs from the shore. The lagoon may be 20 to 40 fathoms deep, hence it becomes navigable. The Great Barrier Reef on the northeastern coast of Australia is 1200 miles long, about 20 to 70 miles wide, and situated nearly 90 miles away from the shore. Third are the atolls. Atolls are rings of reef often encircling an island of sand and coral rubble. They typically have a shallow, sandy sheltered lagoon in the middle. Access to the open sea beyond is through a number of channels. These provide fresh water and colder water for the lagoons. Coral atolls are on the top of submarine mountains. These mountains are remnants of volcanoes. Once there were fringing reefs around the volcano. As it slowly submerged, the corals continued to grow up to the surface of the water. What remained after the volcano became invisible is a ring of coral reefs surrounded by deep oceans. Let us now learn about the theories regarding the formation of coral reefs. Coral reefs grow seaward, but the vertical growth is limited and depends upon the availability of light and the depth of the water. Some samples collected during the modern times show that the thickness of the coral reefs is from 6 meters to more than 1000 meters. The lower parts of many platforms are located below the photic zone, and this can be explained by various theories. The first one is Darwin's subsidence theory. Darwin was of the opinion that on the platform on which the corals grow was unstable and gradually sinking and subsiding down. As the platform goes downward, coral finds it tough to be deeper water, thus they started to grow upward and outward, balancing the subsidence of the land. As the land subsides, the fringing reef would grow upward and outward, resulting into the formation of a lagoon. Further subsidence leads to formation of barrier reef, and as the rapid outward growth of the reefs and coral debris are deposited, so width of the reef is increased. Finally, there is a complete disappearance of land by subsidence, and the barrier reef transforms into an atoll, as has been shown in figure 4. Second theory is Daly's glacial control theory. This theory states that during the last glacial period, the formation of ice caps lowered the ocean level by 60 to 70 meters below the present surface. Wave cuts the shores to make flat platforms suitable for growth of the corals. As the ice caps melted and temperature rose, corals began to grow on these platforms and rose upwards with rising ocean level, and all types of reefs were formed on the pre-existing platforms. There is evidence that coral reefs are growing today on submerged lands, and the foundation of reefs are now at a much greater depth than they were when corals first began to grow. Third theory is the plate tectonics and reef formation. The subsidence theory given by Darwin is supported by modern evidences based on the concept of plate tectonics. The corals grew upward with a rate of 1.8 per thousand years, easily keeping pace with sea level changes. The subsidence theory also deals well with the modern idea of seafloor spreading and subsidence away from the oceanic rises. As a seamount is formed and moves away from hotspot, with the plate and subsides down. The wave action converts the seamount into a flat-topped guyot. Thus, reef building starts upward on the guyot, which keeps pace with the subsidence. Thus, gradually fringing reefs are converted to barrier reefs and atoll with complete subsidence of the island. Importance of coral reefs. In addition to being home to countless marine organisms, coral reefs are very important ecosystems for coastal peoples. They are often the first line of defense against strong tropical storms for coastal communities. At least 400 million people rely on coral reef fisheries for income and food. Coral reefs are vulnerable ecosystems that harbor 25% of all marine species and provide goods and services worth $375 billion annually. Furthermore, high-value tourism in many places relies on healthy, intact coral reefs to attract visitors to remote parts of the world. These services and others combine to make coral reefs extremely valuable to nearby communities. Unfortunately, coral reefs face numerous threats to their continued survival. Destructive fishing practices, pollution, and invasive species threaten local coral reefs in populated areas. Climate change and ocean acidification threaten all coral reefs around the world. Without careful management of human activities and an active reversal of global threats, entire coral reefs may be lost. That loss would risk the million species and hundreds of millions of people that rely on the reefs' existence for their survival. We'll now learn about the threats to coral reefs. Coral reef ecosystems worldwide have been subjected to unprecedented degradation over the past few decades. Despite the high natural, cultural, and economic value of these ecosystems, human activities are a major threat to the persistence of coral reefs. Anthropogenic pressures such as climate change, tourism, fishing, coastal development, eutrophication, and sedimentation are increasingly linked to the severe degradation of coral reefs worldwide, as they can significantly affect the health of the coral animals and its microbial symbionts. Natural disturbances which cause damage to coral reefs include violent storms, flooding, high and low temperature extremes, El Nino Southern Oscillation ENSO events, sub-aerial exposures, and predatory outbreaks. Common threats to the coral reefs include the following. First, climate change. Climate change leads to global warming, and global warming leads to coral bleaching. And it has been predicted that the intensity and severity of coral bleaching will increase in the coming future. Fishing. Fishing processes like cyanide fishing, blast or dynamite fishing, bottom trawling, and muroami, banging of the reefs with sticks. Third is a careless tourism. Careless bloating, diving, snorkeling, and fishing happens around the world, with people touching reefs, stirring up sediments, collecting corals, and dropping anchors on the reefs. Some tourist resorts and infrastructure have been built directly on top of the reefs, and some resorts empty their sewage or other wastes directly into the water surrounding the coral reefs. Fourth is pollution. In the contemporary times, pollution is on the rise. Urban and industrial waste, sewage, agricultural chemicals, and oil pollutions are poisoning the reefs. These toxins are dumped directly into the ocean or carried by the river systems from the sources upstream. Some pollutants, such as sewage and runoff from the farming, increase the level of nitrogen in seawater, causing an overgrowth of algae, which smothers the reefs by cutting off their sunlight. Fifth is sedimentation. Erosion caused by construction, both along the coasts and inland, mining, logging, and farming, is leading to increased sediment in the rivers. This ends up in the ocean, where it can smother corals by depriving them of the sunlight needed to survive. The destruction of mangrove forest, which normally traps large amount of sediments, is exacerbating the problem. Sixth is a coral mining. Live coral is removed from reefs for use as bricks, road fill, or cement for new buildings. Corals are also sold as souvenirs to tourists and to exporters who don't know or don't care about the longer term damage done and harvested for the livestock trade. Coral bleaching. Coral bleaching is a common stress response of corals to many of the various disturbances mentioned above. Coral bleaching occurs when coral polyps lose their symbiotic algae, the zooxanthellae. In the absence of the zooxanthellae, the living tissue are nearly transparent and we can see nearly right through to the stony skeleton, which is white, hence the phenomena is called as coral bleaching. In simple words, it can be understood as zooxanthellae algae are photosynthetic phytoplanktons which prepare food through photosynthesis and provide at least 60% of the food requirement of coral organisms. Thus, coral organisms depend on their symbiotic partner zooxanthellae algae for their survival. Thus, coral bleaching may be defined as a process which causes loss of different colors from coral organisms and turns them white. The bleached coral organisms lose their food supplies due to removal or expulsion of their symbiotic partner zooxanthellae algae from their bodies and ultimately they die of starvation. Beginning in the 1980s, the frequency and widespread distribution of reported coral reef bleaching events increased. Widespread bleaching involving major coral reef regions and resulting in mass coral mortality has raised concerns about linkage of the events to global phenomena including global warming or climate change and increased UV radiation from ozone depletion. Let us now learn about the causes of coral bleaching. It is a known fact now that the coral polyps thrive in shallow water where sunlight is available. Coral reefs live within a relatively narrow temperature margin and very high and very low temperatures of the water lead to their bleaching. This type of bleaching occurs when the temperature drops suddenly due to intense upwelling of water from minus 3 degrees Celsius to minus 5 degrees Celsius for 5 to 10 days. Bleaching also takes place during the summer months. During seasonal temperature, when solar radiation is maximum, it leads to bleaching because of photosynthetically active radiation and ultraviolet radiation. Coral bleaching also takes place when the corals come over the surface water either due to extremely low tides, ENSO-related sea level drops or tectonic uplift, all of which can potentially induce bleaching. Sometimes due to storm-generated precipitation and addition of water due to surface runoff leads to dilution of reef water and this dilution of water leads to bleaching, but this type of bleaching is rare and area-specific. Events of mass coral bleaching. There were two main events of mass coral bleaching that have been recorded in the past. The 1882-83 coral bleaching. The strong El Nino Southern Oscillation event during the 1882-83 caused mass coral bleaching resulting into death of 70% of coral organisms off the coast of Central America in the Pacific Ocean. The strong ENSO event raised the sea temperatures above normal and this raised the temperature of sea's water. When this temperature of sea water increases, even by 1 degrees or 2 degrees Celsius, the symbiotic zooxanthellae algae, which are embedded in the tissue of the coral organisms, are expelled by corals and hence living coral lose color. The 1997-98 coral bleaching. This coral bleaching was one of the most catastrophic bleaching events, which accounted for the large-scale deaths of corals in the tropical oceans of 60 countries and island nations. This event of coral bleaching accounted for 70% death of corals off the coast of Kenya, Maldives, Andaman and Lakshadweep Islands in the Indian Ocean and 75% deaths in Seychelles, marine park systems and the Mafia marine parks of Tanzania was reported by Global Coral Reef Monitoring Network, GCRMN. Coral reefs in India. Despite having a coastline of about 7,500 kilometers and subtropical climate conditions, India have a very few coral reef areas. The place which deserves to have coral reefs is the Bay of Bengal, but unfortunately, coral reefs are absent because of immense quantity of fresh water and silt, being brought by the rivers. Fresh water is harmful for the growth of coral polyps and sediments brought by the rivers, which block the mouth of coral polyps. Another reason for the absence of coral reefs in Bay of Bengal is the heavy monsoonal rainfall and high human presence on the coastline. The mainland coast of India has two widely separated areas containing reefs. Coral reefs in India are mostly found in the Andaman and Nicobar Islands, the Gulf of Mannar, the Gulf of Kutch, and the Lakshadweep Islands. Recently, the Zoological Survey of India reported findings 3 pristine reefs off the coast of Sindhu Durg in Maharashtra. Coral reefs are also found at Goa coast, Kerala coast, and the Pok Bay. Andaman and Nicobar group of islands. The Andaman and Nicobar group of islands are located in the southeast of the Bay of Bengal between 6 degrees 14 degrees north latitude and 91 to 94 degrees east longitude. Almost all the islands of the Andaman and Nicobar groups exhibit narrow, linear, extensively well-developed fringing reefs. The reef flats occupies an area of 795.7 km square. Coral heads and coral shelf occupies 17.5 and 45 square kilometers respectively. 8.4 square kilometers is occupied by mud over reef. According to a study conducted by the Society of Andaman and Nicobar Ecology, SANE, based at Port Blair, there has been mass coral bleaching in 1998 around the Andaman Reef and 30-70% bleaching around the Nicobar Reefs. This bleaching was related to the 2 degrees Celsius rise in temperature from the normal temperature in the Andaman Sea. Second, the Gulf of Mannar. The Gulf of Mannar reefs, on the other hand, are developed around a chain of 21 islands that lie along the 140 km stretch between Tuticorin and Rameshwaram. These islands are located between latitudes 8 degrees 47 minutes north and 9 degrees 15 minutes north and longitude 78 degrees 12 minutes east and 79 degrees 14 minutes east. The islands lie at an average of about 8 kilometers from the mainland. They are a part of the Mannar Barrier Reef, which is about 140 kilometers long and 25 kilometers wide between Pamban and Tuticorin. Different types of reef forms, such as shore platforms, patch, coral pinnacles and atoll types, are also observed in the Gulf of Mannar. The islands have fringing coral reefs and patch reefs around them. Narrow fringing reefs are located mostly at a distance of 50 to 100 kilometers from the island. On the other hand, patch reefs arise from depth of 2 to 9 meters and extend 1 to 2 kilometers in length with width as much as 50 meters. Third, Gulf of Kutch. The Gulf of Kutch, located at 22 degrees 15 minutes to 23 degrees 40 minutes north latitude and 68 degrees 20 minutes to 70 degrees 40 minutes east longitude. The coral formations of the Gulf of Kutch represent one of the extreme northern limits of corals in the Indian Ocean. The approach to the corals is difficult due to the existence of vast intertidal mud flats, which are difficult to negotiate by foot at low tide. The sudden influx of tidal waters also renders it risky to work on the exposed bank. These reefs are mostly of fringing type along the offshore platform reefs, patch reefs and coral pinnacles. There are some 40 islands with patchy coral formation, of which the largest is Piroton Islands. The coral reefs are in a highly degraded condition. The major source of degradation has been mud deposits on various coral reefs, for example, Burul Chunk, Kalubhar, Munde Ka Bet and Jindra Reef. Living coral reef area rarely exceed 20-30%, thus the preventive measures taken in the marine national parks has resulted in the restoration of the area under reefs significantly. Fourth, the Lakshadweep Islands. The Lakshadweep Islands lie scattered in the Arabian Sea about 225 kilometers to 450 kilometers from the Kerala coast. Geographically, the islands lie between 8 degrees north to 12 degrees 3 minutes north latitudes and 71 degrees east to 74 degrees east longitudes. The islands consist of coral formations built up on the Lakadive Chagos submarine ridge, rising steeply from a depth of about 1500 meters to 4000 meters off the west coast of India. There are 36 tiny islands, 12 atolls, 3 reefs and 5 submerged banks covering an area of 32 kilometers square, with lagoons occupying about 4200 kilometers square. Coral reefs of the islands are mainly atoll, except one platform reef at Androth. Almost all the atolls have an orientation of northeast to southwest, with the low-lying islands on the east, a broad, well-developed reef on the west, with a lagoon in between connected to the open ocean by one or more channels. According to a study by National Institute of Oceanography, the coral reefs of the Kavarati and the Kadamat Islands in Lakshadweep have suffered great damage from the coral bleaching due to bacterial diseases and warmer sea temperatures. Figure 5 depicts the major coral zones of India. Status of coral reefs research in India. The major institutions involved in research of coral reefs and management are Department of Ocean Development, the Space Application Center, Ahmedabad, the Zoological Survey of India, Central Marine Fisheries Research Institute, Madurai, Kamraj Institute, CAS at Parangipetai, Annamalai University, Center for Earth Studies, Trivandrum, Institute for Ocean Management, Madras, National Institute of Oceanography, Goa, and the Worldwide Fund for Nature, India. The Space Application Center at Ahmedabad has used remote sensing data to assess the area under coral reefs and prepared a coral reef atlas of India. The Department of Ocean Development has recently received a grant from the World Bank to prepare a CIS-based information system for critical inhabitants for coastal ecosystems. This will include all the coral reefs ecosystem in India, including the patches and submerged banks found along the west coast of India. Let us now learn about the conservation and protection of coral reefs in India. There is much that we can do to locally protect the coral reefs by making sure there is a healthy fish community and that the water surrounding the reefs is clean. Well-protected reefs today typically have much healthier coral populations and are more resilient, that is, better able to recover from the natural disasters such as typhoons and hurricanes. The protection of coral reefs has been stressed under the Wildlife Protection Act 1972 and the Environmental Protection Act 1986 and Coastal Regulation Zone Notification CRZN of 1991 coming under it. Other acts like the Indian Forests Act of 1927, Forest Conservation Act of 1980 and Indian Fisheries Act also offer a sort of relief in the conservation of coral reefs of India. But there is no separate legal status for coral conservation even under the Wildlife Protection Act. The State Forest Department, Fisheries Department and recently the State Coastal Management Authority at the state level are taking up the responsibilities for coral reef conservation in India. Wildlife Protection Act include the protection of major ecosystems. There is no direct stress on coral reefs conservation. So the recommendation for law reform and policy making for coral reefs conservation and management in the country essentially concern amending the Wildlife Protection Act 1972 to include species of corals in the schedules and specifically state that the extraction of corals is prohibited under the provisions of the Chapter 5A of the Wildlife Protection Act. Thank you.